And also, even machines are taking a lot of functions away from us. There are still functions that we have to, you know, deliver ourselves. For example, fatherhood.
Sure.
So how would you educate your five boys?
Actually, I created a little school. Yeah.
What kind of school? Could you describe to us?
Sure. It's small. It's only got 14 kids now, and it'll have 20 kids in September. It's called Ad Astra, which means to the stars. That's maybe a bit different from most other schools, is that there aren't any grades. There's no like not grade one, grade two, grade three type of thing. And making all the children go in the same grade at the same time, like an assembly line.
I know.
You know, because some people love English or languages, some people love math, some people love music, and different abilities at different times. It makes more sense to cater the education to match their aptitudes and abilities. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one principle. Another is that it's important to teach problem solving, or teach to the problem, not to the tools.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be like, let's say you're trying to teach people about how engines work, or you know, you could start by a more traditional approach would be to say, well, we're going to teach all about screwdrivers and wrenches, and you're going to have a course on screwdrivers, a course on wrenches, and all these things. And this is a very difficult way to do it. A much better way would be like, here's the engine. Now let's take it apart. How are we going to take it apart? Oh, you need a screwdriver. That's what the screwdriver is for. You need a wrench. That's what the wrench is for.
Mm-hmm.
And then a very important thing happens, which is that the relevance of the tools becomes apparent.
So all your five boys are in that school?
Yes.
Until when? This is from preschool
to... So far it's only 1 year old. They like it.
They like it?
Yeah.
And you want to keep them away from regular schools?
No, I just didn't see that the regular schools they weren't doing the things that I thought should be done. Like, you know, those two principles, they weren't adhering to those principles. So I thought, well, let's see what we can do. Maybe creating a school will be better. And I actually hired a teacher from the school they were at, who also agreed with me that there was a better way to do it.
Have they surprised you in a way of their innovative thinking?
Yeah, it seems to be going pretty well. I mean, the kids really love going to school. I think that's a good sign. You know, I mean, I hated going to school when I was a kid. It was torture. So the fact that they actually think vacations are too long, like they want to go back to school.
Wow.
Yeah, exactly.
That's weird.
I know.
Well, there are so many young people, the millennial generation, who wants to start up their own company with the, all these accessibility of the internet and such a big market here in China. What's your advice for them? Because sometimes they may easily go to the daydreaming part or the wishful thinking part.
Sure.
What's the balance between imagination and, you know, pragmatism, basically?
I mean, I do think that, you know, in terms of creating a company, you know, what Edison said, which was like, it's 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration, is true. So a lot of it in creating a company is execution. Like, you start off with an idea, and that idea is mostly wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And then you adapt that idea and keep refining it, and you listen to criticism. Some criticism you discard, you try to discard the wrong criticism, try to listen to the correct criticism, and then engage in sort of a recursive self-improvement, and constantly refining it and making it better. And you have to work super hard, that's very important. And then just keep iterating on a loop which says, am I doing something useful for other people? Because that's what a company is supposed to do. You know, a company is just a group of people gathered together to produce a product or service. And a company should only exist if that product or service is truly useful to customers.
Elon Musk 无疑是一个面向未来的梦想家，尽情地描绘未来人类社会的图景。那么他又会如何畅想20年后的自己呢？
I guess, you know, you're not going to be running Tesla all the time, or what's the next step for you?
Well, I certainly I'll be running Tesla and SpaceX into the foreseeable future. You know, I've got a key goal with space, a key goal with Tesla is to be able to make an affordable, great electric car. you know, a sort of third generation mm. car? Because you can only change the world for electric cars if people can afford to buy a great electric car. Affordable electric cars are not great, and the great electric cars are not affordable. Mm. We need the great electric cars that are affordable. So that's the goal with SpaceX, with Tesla. Now with SpaceX, it's a bit of a longer term goal because we need to make reusability work with rockets. That's fundamental mm-hmm. to improving the cost of spaceflight by a factor of 100.
Yeah.
And then we need to make the rockets really big and be able to send large amounts of people and cargo to Mars. And right now, nobody's been mm. to Mars. So this is a very tall hill to climb.
Do you want to be one of those to try the trip?
I'd like to. I mean, I'll go as long as I think SpaceX will be okay without me, then I'll go to Mars.
Mm. So do you feel there is a kind of destiny for you? No?
Sometimes I feel that. But I mean, I don't know if there's any merit to that mm-hmm. feeling.
Mm-hmm. What are the rules that you want to live by? Because it seems that you have broken many rules. But what are some of the rules that you would abide by?
I want to be useful. I want to be able to look back and say that my actions had a good effect on the world.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Elon.
All
thank
right.
you for your time.
Yeah, thanks
have
for having me.
Here.
I really enjoyed the conversation. Yeah.